Welcome to Real Estate First Technology, where you'll get the inside scoop from top producing real estate professionals all around the country, best practices, techniques, and learn about what technology they're using to drive to ensure their success in this world we call real estate.
All right, welcome everyone. Norman Kinsey here. I'm your host here at Real Estate First Technology, where we interview real estate professionals and ask them how they're using technology in their business to grow their business, scale their business, and how it's changed over the years. We have our co-host, Mr. Dan Gandy. Welcome, Dan.
Hey, everybody.
And we have our special guest, Mr. Dave Schubb, the Schubster. Welcome, Dave, to today's podcast.
I didn't know you knew me that well to know that I'm the Schubster.
Well, you know, I heard you're on some buses and you're on CVS signs or something, and you know, you specialize in a community called Rossmore. So I don't know. I heard you're a big thing to talk about.
Well, we'll see.
Love it. Well, welcome to the episode. And starting off the episode, I want to ask you a couple questions about you and your business. And so what areas do you serve, Dave, and how long you've been in the business for?
I started selling real estate in 1970, so it's 50 years now.
Wow, that's awesome. And what areas and what communities do you serve?
Well, my office is in Walnut Creek. I work anywhere in the East Bay, San Francisco, East Bay, really. But as you noted, I do a lot of work in Rossmore.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Awesome. David Schubb specializes in Rossmore and does a really good job. And I think you said now 50% of your business is in Rossmore?
This year, about 50% of my business was in Rossmore, which was quite an increase from previous years.
Wow. That's really cool. Awesome. So what company do you work with?
I'm with Compass.
Okay. And so back when you first started, like, what was the first thing for you that said, real estate is it? I got to get into this business.
Well, I didn't intend to get into this business. My mother is a real estate broker.
Okay.
She started selling real estate about 5 years before me in 1965. Women didn't sell real estate in those days. She went into offices and the broker would look at her and say, "Lady, we don't hire women." But you ought to interview her. She can tell you some stories. She's 93. I was graduating from high school in 1969. I had absolutely no ambitions to do anything in particular. So she gave me some money to go to real estate school. I didn't go to real estate school, but I spent the money. Took the test, missed it by one question, was not happy with that, and applied again, bought a book, studied it the night before, and got a real estate license. Still not really intending to go into real estate,
yeah.
But once I got started, I don't know, there was something about it. It just, I was hooked.
Wow, that's awesome. So were you a team or like your mother and you? Or
no, I actually never worked with her. They didn't have teams in those days. They didn't have a lot of things in those days.
Wow.
And I never worked for her. We worked for the same company for about 2 years before she left and started Better Homes Realty.
Okay.
Awesome.
Wow. Jeez.
Is this back when the MLS used to be like actually printed out?
Yeah, but it wasn't.
That mind, Dan.
It wasn't yet a book. This is even before the book. In fact, I was somewhat instrumental in bringing the real estate book to Contra Costa County. Before that, I had taken a part-time job in 1971 working for a company called Realtron that produced a typewriter sized terminal that had suction cups in it. You put the phone in the suction cups, dialed a number, and it would connect to a computer, and you could download multiple listing information at about 300 baud, if I remember right. I was very excited about this.
Wow.
I took it to the local multiple listing board of directors, and they kind of looked at me like, who's ever going to want to use a computer in the real estate business? So that was pre-book, and the same company was publishing the book. And that was another battle to get them to bring that in. But yeah, it was printed. We didn't have a lot of the things that we have today.
Wow. Well, yeah. There you go. Technology has changed quite a bit. Yeah. Everyone uses a computer now when it comes to real estate.
Well, yeah. We had things you probably aren't even old enough to know what I'm talking about. We had mimeograph machines. We didn't have copy machines yet. Did you ever see a telephone with a rotary dial?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you ever figure out where the expression hang up the phone came from?
No.
No.
Right? You don't hang up a cell phone. We didn't have cell phones. We didn't have fax machines. We didn't have computers, pagers, copy machines. We didn't have condominiums.
Wow.
It's amazing. How things have evolved, really, you know?
They have. And they're still evolving.
Yeah.
Yes. And now it's more complicated. And then it's just like, we talk to agents all the time. They're like, how do I stay up on top of all this? You know, there's just like, geez, there's so much.
Well, especially work for Compass.
Yeah.
For sure.
Every day there's something new. And even the staff, the support staff that's charged with helping us deal with the changes, they'll sit down at a screen with me and they'll go, I've never seen that before. What is this? So it's evolving so quickly, even they can't keep up with it.
Wow.
Makes sense.
Jeez.
Well, just a few questions from my end. And on that note, to parlay from how the evolution of technology is really. So where's your current production level? Like, how many deals are you doing per year, David?
Well, right now, this year I'll probably close about 25 transactions.
Nice. Awesome.
Great job. Great job. And then in terms of technology now that, you know, has used, what technology are you currently using to really facilitate that type of transaction volume in the specific areas that you're doing your business?
Hardware, software, both. Hardware, I'm using a MacBook Air. I just converted to Apple a couple of months ago. I'd been a lifelong Windows user and a longtime Android user.
Mm-hmm. What are you telling about that?
Now I'm using a MacBook Air and an iPhone 11 with the three fancy cameras on the back.
You have the most cutting edge stuff.
Yeah.
I'm trying to figure out how to do that. I'm trying to learn how to more and more use technologies like Zoom to communicate mm-hmm. with clients.
That's awesome.
I'm not doing a very good job of creating video content for websites or social media. I do use some social media. Norm helps me with that a lot.
Because we try.
I'm still not in tune with thinking about while I'm out taking a photograph of something and posting it. Instagram is still a foreign language to me. I can't quite grasp that, but I'm getting better at it. I still use Google for everything. Gmail, calendars, contacts, Google Drive. I can access all of my escrow files with my phone wherever I am, which I do actually more than I'd like to, but somebody sends me a text and says, hey, I can't find a copy of whatever. And I go, hold on, pick up the phone, push a few buttons, and while we're still talking, they'll get it, and they'll go, how'd you do that?
You sound more advanced than some of the younger agents we talk to.
Yeah.
I'm joking.
Yeah, I invented the internet.
I invented that, okay?
Well, I did. You know, I mean, in the early 90s, I was fascinated by it, and why, I don't know. I thought, I wonder if I can teach myself how to create websites. So I taught myself to write HTML. Simple HTML, started creating property websites. I started creating neighborhood websites for the homeowners association that I lived in. Do you remember Bamboo?
Yes.
Do you? I was a Bamboo certified photographer. So I was creating websites with 360 surround videos. So yeah, I guess for some reason I've been hooked into this technology stuff and tend to be a little bit more advanced than a lot of agents, for sure.
Yeah,
you're hired.
When do I start?
Yeah, I know, right?
Yeah. And then last question I have right now is, in terms of some tactics that you've seen work and or methods for technology, it could be, you know, DocuSign, it could be home valuation software. You know, what tool set do you really think is one of the best that you could suggest for clients or for your clients that agents can use from a technology standpoint?
Certainly DocuSign. I started using DocuSign when it first started, and it's amazing how much clients love it. But you know, really, when it comes down to it, what I've found over the decades is that real estate is not about property. It's not about numbers. It's not about anything other than people. It's about people. So. Yeah. The technology, I've never embraced spending a lot of money on lead generation. Mm-hmm. I do a little bit, but what I've found the value of the technology is ways to enhance the personal touch with the client.
Yeah. Being
able to provide the best experience for them. So the technologies are constantly changing, improving. One buys out the other. Somebody else comes up with a better mousetrap, and I'm always trying to find that technology that allows me to be a better communicator. To you know, I like to say that I'm high tech and high touch.
That's awesome.
I love it. So David, from when you first started, before when you even had those books, you know, with the MLS data and the listings that were available to now, how does that affected your business? Has it like made it like faster, or do you feel like you're offering more value now to your clients than you could before because you didn't have the technology you have now, or how does that affected your business from then?
Well, it's not that simple. There's certainly some advantages because we can now send pictures to a client standing in a property, videos to a client standing in a property. We can write a contract without being in the same side of the world as the client. But at the same time, that technology has tasked us with, what am I trying to say? A higher... The clients expect more. They expect you to do more, faster, better. And there's been some stress to that. You know, in the olden days, when I started, the contract was one piece of paper.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And you know what carbon paper is?
Oh, yeah.
Well, a lot of guys your age don't. So we had one page contract with carbon paper. And oftentimes you would write an offer on the hood of your car, and then you would have to drive it somewhere to present it to a seller in person. So it wasn't creating it using zip forms and getting it signed with DocuSign and then emailing it to the other broker to send it to his client. You actually had to write it in front of the person. You actually had to explain things. You actually had to get in your car and deliver it. You had to present it to the seller and hopefully get a signature and then take it back to the client. So that's not as good as what we have today. But at the same time, clients expect me to know pretty much anything and everything about real estate anywhere, not just in Walnut Creek.
Yeah. Wow. So that's when you start to Google?
I wish I had thought of that. I didn't think of that. But you know, when domain names became available for sale, they were $100 a pop.
Wow.
A lot of money.
Yeah.
30 years ago. And I could have bought homes.com. I could have bought house.com. And I thought, $100 is, it's not that important. So who knows?
Wow. Wow. It would have been, people did that. They bought domain names and, you know, they've made hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars from some of these large companies. They're like, I want this domain name. You know, it's just amazing. It's absolutely
amazing. I mean, who knew? You know, when I started creating websites with virtual tours, I mean, what is it that you're buying from companies now? They're selling you packages where they come out, they take the photography, they create the website.
Yeah.
You know, of course, in those days when I did it, I could get $1,000 per website because it was all done by hand and nobody else did it. And the high-end brokers that wanted it would pay it.
Wow. That's amazing.
That's an amazing story. That's awesome.
That's why I wanted Dave to be on the show. So Dave, where do you see your business in 5 years? And could you imagine how technology is going to affect your business as the next 5 years come along?
I think my business is going to continue on as it has. That I'm fortunate that I've survived the cycles that I've survived this long, and most of my business comes from referrals or repeat clients. So I'm not reliant on knocking on doors anymore. I'm not reliant on trying to gather leads through some lead generation utility and then dumping them into a CRM, which we didn't have in those days either. And that we used to use Rolodexes and 3x5 cards to do sort of the same thing.
Your little black box.
Yeah, mine was sort of gray. I mean, I can tell you stories of when REO started in the early 80s about, you know, getting on airplanes to go knock on doors because that was the only way you could get in front of people.
Wow.
So, you know, fortunately, I don't have to do that stuff anymore. And where I see my business headed, I'm hoping, will be more of a concentrated effort in Rossmore, more time spent with referrals and repeat business. I have children of past clients that are now clients. I have grandchildren of past clients that are now clients.
Wow.
The technology, as it continues to move along, will just be an evolution of that. It'll be more of the Zoom type interaction. Brokers, I don't think, still don't use FaceTime much. Do you find that?
Wow.
Not much. We see video from a listing perspective and, you know, on the presentation and outbound marketing, but in terms of communicating with clients, I deal with a lot of customers and they'll just say, text me, right?
Yeah, but why? You would think, when I was coaching for a while and I would insist that we'd have a face-to-face video, whoever it was, and there were a lot of clients that was like, I don't have my makeup on or my hair's not, and I don't want you to see me in my bathrobe, you know. And that was, I guess maybe that's part of it. But I would hope that the technology would allow even a better personal close-up connection with the client that we have. I'm pretty sure that the presentation of properties is certainly going to increase. We're seeing virtual staging. We're seeing companies that will enhance photos. I currently sit on the MLS Business and Technology Committee at the Contra Costa Association of Realtors, and we're constantly looking at these types of products, glide.com, disclosures.io, software programs to keep agents safe out in the field.
Yeah.
There's all kinds of enhancements in technology that will hopefully make us better agents.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, as long as the MLS, you know, and the local boards and associations stay on top of it, I think that will be good. And I know that there's a lot of automation happening too. So we'll see with Open Door and some other companies like that are trying to do more of the automation of the process. So it'd be interesting to see where the industry heads in the next 5 to 10 years as technology does make things more streamlined and easier. So
my view of the Open Door isn't really about technology. It's about making money. those companies, they do make it easier to make the they make the transaction quicker.
Yeah.
But there's a cost to it. You know, the studies I've seen indicate that sellers are taking somewhere around a 17% below market price for their properties compared to putting it on with the broker and paying 5% or 6% or 7%, whatever the broker charges them.
Yeah.
So, and right now it's about, I think, 5% of the market. But yeah, I think that'll continue to grow. There's a place for it. The market's is changing. The market will change again. Real estate is cyclical. So when it starts heading down the other side of the cycle, those types of businesses may not survive. I've seen a lot of companies come and go as they'd come when the market was in one part of the cycle and they would go when it was in a different part of the cycle.
I was going to chime in and say that I think you'll never replace the relationship and the expertise, right? The relationship and the expertise are the two things that an agent brings to the transaction, where technology, it may have historical data and statistics, but it's not having a face-to-face, and it's not being able to say, there's great restaurants on this corner, and your kids want to go to this school, and this, and this, and this, and providing that real personal touch that real estate brings.
And more than that, it's a very intricate, complicated process. You've got a unique seller, a unique buyer, probably two unique agents, a unique property, and who knows what else ends up in there. So, you know, although when we start out with an escrow, we know where we want to end up, but you usually can't draw a straight line from beginning to end. You usually start off in that direction, and all of a sudden you run into something and you're making a hard right turn to avoid the problem. And now you're trying to figure out, how do I get back there? So, you know, absolutely the experience, the knowledge that comes from the experience, the knowledge of what not to do, which comes from experience, are all things that at this point in time, artificial intelligence can't solve. And more than that, real estate is highly emotional. So have you bought a house?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I just bought his.
How was it?
In the 11th hour or the, you know, crunch time, 5 minutes before close, like sitting in the parking lot at the title agency, you're sweating, you're about to sign a book of papers, like it's the biggest purchase you'll ever make. So
it's stressful.
Yeah, right? It's stressful. Your wife's asking you a bunch of questions you don't understand, and you're trying to send emails out to the agent. it's really, even post-transaction, like how the whole process.
Look at what my job entails. It's not simply knowing what's in the MLS book.
Yeah.
The MLS. And the old days when the book came out, it was, oh my, people are going to get a hold of this book and we're going to be out of business. That's what the brokers thought. When the internet came along, brokers, the old guard in Walnut Creek was, we can't do this. The brokers on the other side of the hill are going to come here and sell our listings. And my response was, well, yeah. Isn't that what we want? No, we don't want them taking our buyers, right?
Yeah.
So you know, that's just in the industry and dealing with the client. They're freaked out about all of a sudden they're going to be making a $10,000 a month house payment. They're freaked out about, where am I going to get $250,000 for a down payment, or if they're fortunate enough to have it, oh, I'm going to have to take $250,000 out of the bank to buy something. And what happens if it's no good? And what happens if the price goes down? And what happens if, you know, what about my kids going to school and the commute now is, so it's...
So true.
You're right. Technology is not going to replace us.
It's funny how that works, though, how technology, people freak out at the beginning.
I always like to ask this question, you know, for a new agent getting into the business, what would you suggest is one of the, what's your best piece of advice? I think that's what I wanted to ask.
Well, my number one piece of advice would be know what the contract says. Virtually none of the agents, I don't care how long they've been in the business, haven't got a clue as what the real estate purchase agreement says.
Interesting.
So that would be number one. And then after that, you know, find a brokerage that has good training. Maybe get on a team where you have a mentor that can show you the way. There is no one way. That's the other thing about the real estate business, and it's constantly changing. Some agents are better with buyers, some are better with sellers, some are better with expired listings, some are better with lead management, some are better in property management, some are better in office management. There's unlimited fields that an agent can use to make money. And you know, as I said, when I started, we didn't have condominiums. We didn't. Wow. You know, your financing was 20% down. You had to have a 25% ratio. And if you were married, the wife's income didn't count.
Wow.
Because women had babies, they'd stay home. So banks wouldn't make them loans. In fact, in the early days, a woman couldn't buy a house on her own unless her husband or her father co-signed for her.
Wow.
Yeah, wow.
How things have evolved. That's amazing.
That's just in my experience.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Geez, to put things in perspective, I mean, geez, my wife, you know, I came in and she already owned. So I was just like, okay, well, that works out for me. And it's just like, geez, that's amazing to think about that concept. So we got a couple more questions getting closer to the end of the show. And what I want to ask you is any books, podcasts, like anything that like a new agent could listen to or deep dive into that potentially could give them some advice or some things to think about as they grow their business?
I need to do a better job of listening to somebody's advice on that. I'm not big on reading books. I almost never listen to podcasts.
Okay.
What I do, though, every morning is when I get up, I pretty much spend about an hour reading Inman, reading Housing Wire, reading some of the other online publications that give information on what's going on. I'm involved to a much larger degree than ever in local association, real estate association activities. I've learned so much in the last 3 years, 4 years, being a director at the Contra Costa Association of Realtors, being a director at the California Association of Realtors, being on different committees and getting firsthand knowledge about some of the new laws that have come in or some of the bills that were pending, like AB 1482, learning about technology, learning about all kinds of things. So for me, it's not specifically about reading this book, that book, or the other book, or listening to this podcast or the other, but it's more about spending time every day throughout the day, kind of ingesting whatever comes across the computer screen.
Okay. So you do a little bit of reading then.
I don't know, but I should be reading books. And in fact, one of the guys here in the office is starting a book club, and I think I'm going to do it. I can't remember the last time I sat down and read a book.
There you go. Well, what I like to do is I downloaded Audible, and your first book is free. And I like, you know, driving in traffic, go to the gym. I just listen to a book. And for me, it helps me out because I'll start reading and I'll be like thinking about other stuff. I'm like, I'm supposed to be reading. What am I thinking about the other stuff for? So
maybe you can send me a list and I can.
Yeah.
The audio books, I just don't have the patience to sit there. My mind starts wandering. And
Yeah. I have to be doing something. If I'm in the car in traffic, if I'm working out, if I'm doing something, I'll listen to it. I'm definitely not just sitting there on the couch listening to a book. I can't do that either.
No, I'm in the car. I'm usually on the phone.
Yeah, that's true.
There's technology that's made a huge change in the real estate business. You know, I had a radio telephone in my car in the middle 70s, that was a big deal. Yeah, it was like a ship-to-shore radio. But yeah, when it's a big difference now having the ability to spend time driving and working, talking on the phone. And
yeah, I can only really imagine. I remember when they had the cars and the phone, the first set of car phones. You know, it was hardwired in.
I had one of those. It's like an army thing on a shoulder strap, and you pulled it out, and it was on a coil, and yeah.
That's just amazing. All right, so the last question, we like to leave the floor open. So is there anything you want the viewers and also listeners to hear? Anything, the floor is yours, and go ahead and take it away.
Well, where do I start? I don't know. I'd rather answer questions than try to just tell some story that nobody may be interested in.
Dave Schubb's so humble. Normally, we always get our guests to say, send me your referrals.
Well, doesn't that go without saying?
I guess it
exactly.
does.
Exactly.
I said it for you, Dave.
Well, thanks. No, I mean, truthfully, I always welcome new business, and I greatly enjoy helping people solve these issues. It's I'm a lucky guy. It's not so much about having to make money this week. It's to me, it's what's always kind of been about providing the best experience and figuring out how to solve the puzzle. To me, that's what this is. It's a puzzle. And when somebody needs something and you're trying to find a way to get it, there's always going to be roadblocks. How do you get around the roadblocks? How do you convince the other side that what you want is in their best interest? So it's always interesting to me. It's not work.
That's awesome. That's cool. At least you know you're doing something that you're destined to do, and you love what you're doing because it's not work.
And I don't know how to do anything else. I mean, when you think about it, I've never had a real job.
Hey, well,
I started doing this right out of high school.
You're the most experienced agent we've ever had on this show, hands down. Some of the best history I've ever heard.
Yeah,
so. You haven't heard. You only heard a little bit of it. There's 50 years of stuff that went on. I got involved in REO in the first cycle in the early 80s, and that was the wild, wild west. That was trailblazing. We created programs for the banks. We created the processes that went on to become nationwide. It was all uncharted territory. There's a lot of fascinating stories there.
Wow.
I don't know. What else have I seen over the years?
We're going to have to have, because we're getting closer to the end of our time schedule here, but we'll definitely have to have Dave on again, because he has so many stories and so many things to talk about. So if any of the listeners and viewers want Dave Schubb to come back on the show, let us know. We'll love to have him again, because I've actually met Dave multiple times, and I actually not sat in that office, but sat in other offices with Dave over there in Walnut Creek, and he's told me some stories. So he's been a very fascinating guy.
Well, you need to come visit.
I will.
You ought to see the kitchen we have here. Like tech companies. Unbelievable, the food in here.
I love it.
Dave's like, I gained like 10 pounds, man, over here eating all the snacks. Yeah. Well, we appreciate you being on the show today, Dave. We appreciate our co-host, Mr. Dan Gandy, and all the listeners and viewers that are out there listening in and viewing our podcast today. We're going to go ahead and end the episode. So thank you for tuning in. We'll see you next week, and good luck out there with your businesses. And if you want to be on the show, of course, reach out to us, send us a direct message, and join our family with our Real Estate vs. Technology Facebook group page that we have out there as well. And until the next time, take care and have a good rest of your day. Thank you for tuning into today's episode. We hope you found value and took something you can apply to your business today. Be sure to join our community on Facebook, Real Estate vs. Technology, all spelled out. Also, subscribe to our YouTube channel. We would appreciate it. It's Real Estate Tech. And of course, if you or someone else you know would like to be a part of our show, just go ahead and send us an email. It's reversetechtalk@gmail.com. And we'll see you next week.